And whenever you lose sight of the coming of the Lord, complacency sets in and carnality in the life of people. All through history, we've seen that. And I think it's really important that we understand that the judgment of God has been held back because of the grace of God and because the church is still here on the earth.
Welcome to Somebody Loves You Radio, the Bible teaching ministry of Roll Reese in Diamond Bar, California. We are glad to have you with us today for Roll's continued study of 2 Kings. Contemplating one ruler's destructive spiritual concessions, you'll get a challenge to learn from his mistakes and make sure you're following God's ways instead of the world's. Roll will show us how questionable company and constant compromise can add up to a life that dishonors God and grieves the Holy Spirit. Here's Roll Reese in 2 Kings chapter 3.
He continues the story. He now is going to be dealing with King Jehoram of Israel, the northern kingdom. Remember, when we mention Israel, it's the northern kingdom. Judah is the southern kingdom. He says, now Jehoram, the son of Ahab, became king over Israel at Samaria in the 18th year of Jehoshaphat, here it is, king of Judah, and reigned for 12 years. So here we have Jehoram became not only the king of Israel after his brother Ahaziah had died, and he ruled from 852 through 841 B.C., and then you have the king Jehoshaphat of the southern kingdom. And check this out. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord, but not like his father and mother, but he put away the sacred pillars of Baal, and notice that his father had made. Now, it says that he wasn't a full idolater like his dad and his mother. But at the same time, he did continue in idolatry. The sadness of idolatry. There wasn't a full commitment to the Lord. There wasn't the full putting away of the idols, especially the idols of fertility, Baal worship, the god of storms, the god of the sky. And one of the things that we need to understand is that religion worships everything and anything. But Christianity has one person that we worship, period. And that is Jesus Christ that brings us to faith in salvation. Nobody else can do that. Only Jesus Christ. And so it's really important that we don't compromise our position when we're talking to people in agreeing with them, because we don't want to be offensive in sharing our faith with them. You can be loving and caring and graceful and don't compromise. You see, you can come back and say, well, excuse me, but the Bible says. We want to make sure that we're biblical in the statements we make, in the doctrine we teach, in the things that we share with people. And somehow in here, Jehoram compromise his position by not putting away completely idolatry. You see? But he continue on. He says, nevertheless, he perished in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who had made Israel to sin, and he did not depart from them. And now Misha, king of Moab, now we're talking about the king across the way. That is, if you're in Israel and you're in Jerusalem and you're heading out towards the wilderness area of Judea, let's say if you're going out to Masada or the Dead Sea, once you get to Jericho and you make a right turn going over to Masada or the Dead Sea, as you're going out there, over to your left, you will see across the Dead Sea these huge mountains. Those are called the mountains of Moab. That's where the city of Petra is, on the other side of Jordan. And Moab, not only had been against Israel from the beginning, from the time of the Exodus, and God had cursed them. They've always had come against the children of Israel. And at this particular time, the king of Moab saw that the king of Israel died. And he said, hey, this guy always oppressed us. Hey, let's stand up and let's go against them before they have another king. And let's do them all in. The nation of Israel. And notice what it says. And now Mesa, king of Moab, was a sheep breeder. And he regularly paid the king of Israel 100,000 lambs of wool and 100,000 rams. They had to really pay a tax to the northern kingdom of Israel, even though they were on the other side, you see. So they were in bondage to Israel, to the northern kingdom of Israel. And now that they see that the king has died, they say, hey, we don't have to pay taxes anymore. Why don't we try to get out of it by invading them and getting rid of them? Verse 5. But it came to pass, or it happened, when Ahab died, that the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. And so the king Jehoram went out of Samaria at that time and mustered all of Israel. So they hear that the king of Moab is going to come against Israel. And what do? He goes out and he's beginning to plead with the people. Hey, let's get ready for battle. We're going to battle. And then notice what it says. And then he went out and he sent to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, saying, he sent him a letter. The king of Moab has rebelled against me. Will you go with me and fight against Moab? And he said, I will go up with you. I am as you are, and my people as your people, and my horses as your horses. Now, remember one thing. This is not confusing. The northern kingdom of Israel were idolaters. They were the ones that settled up in the northern part of Galilee called Tel Dan today. And they began to worship the golden calves. Jeroboam, remember at the beginning, said, hey, you know what? We moved out here. Why go to Jerusalem and worship in Jerusalem when we can worship right here where we are? So why don't we make an altar for the Lord? And we'll make two golden calves and we'll worship the Lord like that. And that's where idolatry began. And Baal worship in the northern part of Israel. God allowed them to become idolaters until finally God fed up with them. He gave them about 170 years to repent. And we're going to get to about 2 Kings chapter 11 or 12. Where we come to that place where God gets fed up after all this idolatrous worship. And what does he do? He takes the northern kingdom of Israel and he judges them by using Assyria to come and make them, take them captive and literally put hooks on their noses, put hooks to their lips, chains, kill family members, maim and cripple, and then lead them into destruction or lead them into captivity. And then the remaining remnant of Israel, the people that remain with the actual people of Assyria, intermarried together, and they became literally half-breeds, and even today they're called the Samaritans. You see? The Samaritans. Remember when Jesus was walking through Samaria? And the woman at the well came and said, hey, the Jews have nothing to do with the Samaritans. Half Jew, half Assyrian, when they intermixed in their marriage at the judgment in 722 BC when God judged the northern kingdom of Israel. So here we're leading to that, preparing the way. Watch again. In verse 8, now notice that he's asking the king of the south to come and help. This is his request. And what's amazing is that the king of the south says, hey, you know what? You're my brother. I'll go help you. What is he doing? The Bible tells us that evil company corrupts good morals. You see? A lot of times we want to be nice to people, but if they're evil people, we should not compromise our position. The king of Judah compromises. just because he's in Judah and says, you're my people, so I want to come and help you, knowing that he was an idolatrous king. And at the same time, the king of the south, already was beginning to introduce idol worship, and then they would be judged later on by God, as God would use Babylon to come and take them captive. Notice 3 sieges against Jerusalem, and take the Ark of the Covenant and take them to Babylon for 70 years. You see, it's all leading to that. The book of Kings and 1st and 2nd Chronicles. The judgment of God over his own people. The northern kingdom, the southern kingdom of Israel. I wonder how long before God judges America. Think about it for a moment. Look at all the evil we have. Monday night, we were down at the beach having a dinner with my sons. And we were there at Laguna Beach. And we were out looking at the surf as the guys were surfing. And down below us, there were 2 guys. And they had short haircuts like Marines. We thought they were an R&R. I said, oh, look, a couple Marines, man. They're probably an R&R. And then they sat on the rocks. And all of a sudden, they got real close together and put their arms around each other. And they started kind of touching each other. I said, oh, man. In public. No shame. No shame. And when we look at television, I mean, they're not watching their language anymore. Regular TV. Nudity. Cursing. Blasphemy. Magazines. You go down to the grocery store and they have racks full of magazines that are very sensual. And it seems like everything that we do is to appeal the flesh. And yet at the same time, we can go back in history and we can read about Sodom and Gomorrah. We can read about the northern kingdom of Israel. We can read about Judah. And all the way through, we can see the hand of God. When God gets fed up, then he brings his judgment.
This is Somebody Loves You Radio with Roll Reese. Don't forget, we're here to help you stay in step with God as you walk in obedience to His Word. If you have Bible questions you'd like Roll to personally address, you can email him at PastorRoll@SomebodyLovesYou.com. And for more resources, visit our website, SomebodyLovesYou.com. Let's continue now with more of today's lesson.
And then you see that complacency in so many people's lives today. Not recognizing, not knowing that the nation of Israel in the book of Matthew chapter 24, when he speaks of the budding of the fig tree, it's literally a symbol of the nation of Israel. It's not what's happening in Iraq. It's not what's happening all over the world. The main thing is the nation of Israel. And Jesus said this, when you see the Jews after 1900 years of being spread out throughout the whole world and they come back to their homeland, know one thing, that generation will not pass away. Listen, we are that generation. And yet people today don't believe that Jesus is coming again. Many people do not believe that. If people today in the church really believe that the Lord could probably come back tonight or tomorrow morning or in the afternoon or maybe next week or the next month, listen, churches would be jam-packed. Not because they're afraid, but preparing for eternity because Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming back. And whenever you lose sight of the coming of the Lord, complacency sets in and carnality in the life of people. All through history, we've seen that. And I think it's really important that we understand that the judgment of God has been held back because of the grace of God and because the church is still here on the earth. We are the salt of the earth. We are a light on a hill. And I think it's really important that we understand that as we're studying and reading and praying, that we would learn from the lessons that we're instructing you in so that we don't make the same mistakes they made. That's why they're written. So that you and I don't make the same mistake. But that we learn. That we learn about the holiness of God. That we learn that our commitment to Jesus Christ has to be 100%. This king is having fellowship with the king of the north to attack Moab. And what he's doing is what? Be you not unequally yoked together with a non-believer. He's associating with evil. He's mixing in, trying to be nice. Listen, God has called you, God has called me to be separate. Separate. Not to be hermits, you know, and go in a cave and get away from everybody. That's not what he's called to do. But he's called us to walk in obedience to him and by faith. And to live lives that are holy. To live lives that are with conviction. You see, it's not how close I can get to the edge, but how far can I stay back from the edge. That's the key to the grace of God. You don't want to tempt God by getting away at the edge. You could slip and fall at any time. You want to stay away from the edge. It's dangerous. There are too many people today that are standing halfway to the edge, and many of them already are on the edge. False ground. How we need to make a stand for righteousness. For anything and everything that has to do with the kingdom of God. And yet, notice in verse 7 what he says. Then he went out and sent Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, saying, the king of Moab has rebelled against me. Will you go with me and fight against Moab? And he said, I will go up. I am as you are. My people are your people. My horses are your horses. Same thing that Ahab the king said. And you know what? That's being unequally yoked together. He should have never gone up. You should never go up and associate with evil people. They'll bring you down. You won't bring them up. They'll bring you down before you bring them up. God has warned us about the light and the darkness. Not hanging out in areas and places where you're tempting God and you're tempting him to the point where you'll slip and you'll fall and then Satan will get a hold of your life. You see, you have to be careful. We are not to tempt the Lord your God in any way. Then verse 8, look what he says. Then he said, which way shall we go? And he answered, by the way of the wilderness of Edom. Hey, let's go around, attack Israel by the Dead Sea. Let's go around behind them. And so the king of Israel went with the king of Judah and the king of Edom, and they marched on the roundabout, notice route, 7 days, and there was no water for the army nor for the animals to follow them. Now, can you imagine? They went to battle, but they forgot water. Water is the most important thing in the desert, you see. And here's a situation that they're going into the wilderness and they're not bringing water, which is what? Bad planning. Bad planning. Because what they're doing is they're weakening what? The army. For defeat, not for victory. But then what happens? Notice verse 9. And so the king of Israel went with the king of Judah, the king of Edom. They marched in the roundabout route 7 days, and there was no water for the army or for their animals to follow them. And the king of Israel said, alas, for the Lord God has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. Notice that. The word alas is a word of despair in the Hebrew. But Jehoshaphat said, is there no prophet of the Lord here that we may inquire of the Lord by him? So one of the servants of the king of Israel answered and said, oh yeah, by the way, Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is here, who pour water on the hands of Elijah. So here now they're desperate, and the king Jehoshaphat says, what? Is there no prophet among us today? Yeah, there's a prophet here by the name of Elisha. And Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Edom, went down to him. So they're going to go get counsel. And Elisha said to the king of Israel, now notice, when the king comes to Elisha the prophet, Elijah rebukes him. I like Elijah. Rebukes him. He's no respecter of persons. Watch what he says. He says, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother. Who's that? The prophets of Baal. You see? Why are you coming to me? You don't even believe in Jehovah God. Your parents didn't believe in him, and now you don't believe either. But the king of Israel said to him, no, for the Lord has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. And Elisha said, as the Lord of hosts lives, before whom I stand, surely, were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you. The only reason I'm talking to you is because of the king of Judah. That's the only reason. Because he has mixed emotions, he has a mixed heart. And Elisha said, again, verse 15, but now bring to me a musician. And then it happened when the musician played that the hand of the Lord came upon him. Now, notice that in verse 14, he's telling us how we need to realize that we all stand before the Lord. And we need to be aware that God's presence and the eyes of the Lord are going throughout the earth looking for someone that will say, here am I, Lord, send me. You see? The presence of God is everywhere. We can't hide from the presence of God.
Well, if you've been feeling the Holy Spirit's conviction about sinful compromises in your life, we encourage you to respond with repentance and a renewed commitment to obedience. You're listening to Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese. To get a copy of today's lesson from 2 Kings chapters 3 and 4, just call us at 800-634-9165 and we'll send a copy to you for a donation of $5 or more. We'd also like to offer you Raul's book titled Sin, The Root of All Evil. It's a resource that will further challenge you to give God your undivided heart and show you how to guard against temptation as you make the daily decision to surrender to His Lordship. You'll see that even in life's smallest decisions, you have the opportunity to worship and glorify God. To order Raul's insightful book titled Sin, The Root of All Evil, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165. We'll send your copy for a donation of $8 plus shipping and handling. That's 800-634-9165. Or write us at Somebody Loves You Radio, P.O. Box 4440, Diamond Bar, California, 91765. Watch Raul on his YouTube channel every Tuesday at 10 a.m. West Coast time for Straight Talk, a Q&A program with helpful guidance for a God-honoring life. And every one of these programs has also been archived for you to download through Spotify or iTunes. Plus, you can contact Raul directly with prayer requests and Bible questions by emailing him at pastorraul@somebodylovesyou.com. We are grateful for your partnership. Every gift helps us keep sharing the Bible's wisdom and inspiration. And thanks again for including us in your day today. We love spending these moments with you meditating on God's Word, and we encourage you to join us again next time as we return to Scripture for more life-giving, life-shaping insights from the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's Raul once again with a closing comment.
So if we become, notice, aware that no matter whether I go to church or I go to work or I go to the movie place or I go to the mall or wherever I am going, God goes with me. The problem with a lot of us, it's like this. We're going into a place where God really should not be in. So you say, okay, God, wait out here. I'll come back out, pick you up, and we'll get on our way. That's the mentality, the earthly mentality. It doesn't work like that. You can't leave God out. He goes in. The problem is that when God goes in, God doesn't go out. Guess what? The Holy Spirit gets grieved. Because he's a person. That's what sin does. You see? That's why we really need to ask the question, would the Lord feel comfortable in this place? Would he come here? What would he do? And when I look at everything that I try to do in my life, how is this going to give glory and honor to the Lord Jesus Christ? And if it does, then do it. If it doesn't, don't do it. Because it will hurt you and it will hurt the Lord. That's why it's so important to understand that we all are standing in the presence of God.
This program is sponsored by Somebody Loves You Radio in Diamond Bar, California.